رحمه الله من قرأ سورة المباركة الفاتحة. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله العلي العظيم الكبير على كل منعم وفقير الذي جعل الحمد درج المعارج والشكر سلاما لكل المنازل والمدارج فأرسل رسل هداة إلى خير السبيل فهو الذي بعث في الأميين رسولا منهم يتلو عليهم آياته ويزكيهم ويعلمهم الكتاب والحكمة وإن كانوا من قبل لفي ضلال مبين ثم الصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين سيدنا ونبينا وحبيب إله العالمين الذي سمي في السماء بأحمد وفي الأرض بأبي القاسم محمد. ثم الصلاة والسلام على أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين المظلومين المشردين من أوطانهم فاللعنة الدائمة على أعدائهم من الآن إلى يوم الدين. أما بعد، السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. We have been talking about the Quran. In specific, we've been trying to understand some of the godly values that emanate out of this Quran so that we can imbibe and integrate them into our daily life in order for us to transform, in order for us to attain that proximity and closeness to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Tonight, I would like to deal with one important aspect of Karbala, which is its divine decree and the divine design for the occurrence of the tragedy of Karbala and analyze it from the Quran. Historically, we've been made to understand the event of Karbala took place because of several reasons. One of them is that the Imam was forced to pay an allegiance and he refused to do so. Two, once he traveled to Mecca, he started receiving invitation from the people of Kufa. And then he proceeded to Kufa to establish a righteous government. Three, the third reason that the Imam himself is recorded to have said through the will that he wrote to his half-brother Muhammad ibn Hanafiya, he states that he wanted to establish virtue. He wanted to eliminate vice. He wanted to bring about reformation in a corrupt society. And he wants to introduce the holy, godly lifestyle of the Prophet and Imam Ali alayhi salam. These are some of the reasons and the goals of the uprising of Karbala. However, if you scan the literature, there are a number of riwayats that are narrated to us on the events of the tragedy of Karbala. And there is one reason that is mentioned, and it keeps on repeating itself, and that is God planned it. One, right from the time when the Imam visits the Prophet's grave before his final departure in Medina. Two, on his arrival in Mecca. Three, in his explanation to Muhammad ibn Hanafiya. Four, in his explanation to other companions who wanted to dissuade him and persuade him from not making this movement. And five, in his declaration at the time on his way from Mecca to Karbala and Karbala itself. He keeps on repeating this one phrase. It was God's decree. And that is why I am making this movement. Question, what does it mean to me? What does it mean to us? So allow me to quote you then three traditions or three examples, and then we can analyze them further. Tradition number one. There is a well-known incident that is narrated that he went for the final farewell at the grave of the Holy Prophet. It is narrated that he kept his head on the grave and he was immediately transported and he began to see a vision. He was not asleep. He was not in a state of dream. These powerful souls had the capacity to detach themselves from the physical world and divert their total attention to the realm of spirituality. And he experiences a vision there. He saw the prophet come with a party of angels on his right, in front of him, and on his left. And the prophet addresses him according to this narration. He tells him, Ya Habibi, Ya Hussein, O my dear grandson, O Hussein. كأني أراك قريبا مرملا بدمائك. I see very soon that you shall be rolling in the sand, in the dirt, and in blood. He says, Ya Habibi, Ya Hussein, O my grandson Hussein. I see you madbuhan bi ard karbin wa bala. I see you that you shall be slaughtered on the grounds of Karbala. Ya Habibi, Ya Hussein, O my grandson Hussein. I see you thirsty and nobody is ready to give you water. I see you hungry and nobody is ready to feed you. He says, Ya Habibi, Ya Hussein, O my grandson Hussein. Inna abaka wa ummaka wa akhaka qadimu alayya. That I see your father and I see your mother and I see your brother. They are with me. Mushtaquna ilayk. They are waiting for you. Come over. Observe the message. Come over. Why did the Imam make this move? According to this riwayah, it was a divine plan. And he had to follow that plan. In another tradition, he says that yet another tradition, Ibn Hanafiyyah, his half-brother, advises him, do not proceed to Kufa. The people of Kufa have betrayed our father. Why don't you go to Yemen? We have more supporters in Yemen. And the Imam says to him, allow me to ponder over this. The next day, the Imam makes his move and he proceeds to Mecca. Muhammad ibn Hanafiyyah rushes out and catches up with the Imam. He says, but you promised to think about it. You promised that you will not go to Mecca. The Imam replies to him, listen to this. He says, what can I do? Sha'allahu yarani qatila. He says, it's a divine plan and I have to be killed. One more riwayat. So you have a perspective of this idea of the decree of God. Yet a third tradition. In Mecca, the Imam is about to depart the next day. The day previous to his departure, he gives out a sermon. And notice that one of the reasons he's departing from Mecca is the fear of assassination from Yazid's henchmen. But the direction that he's going to take now, he will proceed towards Kufa because he has received more than 18,000 letters of invitation of a support, an invitation coming from Kufa. These are all hopes of victory and support. I arrive there. We remove the corrupt government and we establish a righteous government. Observe the speech. He says, Alhamdulillah, ma sha Allah wa la quwwata illa billah wa sallallahu ala rasulihi. And then he says, khudta al-mautu ala wuldi Adam, makhadta al-qaladati ala jidil fata. He says, let me tell you that the death for the human being is just like that wonderful necklace on a young girl's neck. Amazing. You have been promised support and you are talking about death and the desirability of death. No, he goes further. The Imam says it's not only about the desirability of death. He goes one step further. He says, Ma awlahani ila asla fi ishtiyaq Yaqub ila Yusuf. He says, you know how intensely I desire death? Just like Yaqub, he deeply longed to be joined with Yusuf. Declaration of death. Death is definite. Death is desirable. Death is deeply desirable. Amazing. And then he explains. He says, خُيِّرَ الْمَصْرَوْ عَنَ الْأَقِيِّ. He says, it has been decided, it has been decreed, I shall meet this end, and I am ready for it. I am longing for it. I am deeply longing for it. كَأَنِّي بِأَوْصَالِي تَتَقَطَّعَ أَصْلَانُ الصَّلَوَاتِ بَيْنَ النَّوَاوِيسِ وَكَرْبَلَا. He says, I can see myself, these animals brutally chopping parts of my body between Nawawis and Karbala. He says, لا محيص يوم خطل بالقلم. He says, it has been decreed. The pen has written it. And therefore, I cannot avoid it. The day shall come. رضا الله رضانا أهل بيت. If God has decreed it, we the Ahl al-Bayt are in total submission to the will of God and we accept it. نَصْبِرُ عَلَىٰ قَضَائِكَ. We shall remain steadfast and determined because it is the decree of God. وَيُوَفِّنَا أُجُورَ الصَّابِرِينَ. And of course, He's going to reward us, God, the tremendous reward promised to those who are steadfast and who are resistant and who are determined in the way of God. أَلَىٰ مَنْ كَانَ بَاذِلًا فِينَا مُحْجَتَهُ. He's addressing the people in Mecca. He says, I ask you, whoever amongst you is ready to give out the gift of his blood, of his heart, his whole life. Whoever is ready to share with us the gift of his life. وَمُوَطِّنَا عَلَىٰ لِقَاءِ لِهَا نَفْسِ. And if he is ready to go back to his hometown. We all came from there and we are all going back there. Do you want to come with me? Are you ready to meet your Lord? فَلْيَرْحَلْ مَعَنَا فَإِنِّي رَاحِلٌ مُصْبِحًا. Tomorrow morning, I'm going to depart. Come and join me. So in summary, true, one, politically he was invited to go to Kufa. Two, true, he was forced to swear allegiance and he refused to do so. Three, true, he said that the purpose was to eliminate and establish virtue. But one factor that we need to understand clearly is the divine decree. Allow me therefore tonight to analyze this particular reason, because potentially the entire tragedy of Karbala can become in a sense meaningless for us, as it will no longer be a role model. Oh, it was decreed. There was no way out. It had to happen. And Imam was chosen to do it. And Imam submitted to it. So what is in it for me? How do I take this tragedy then to be a role model? Right? Three questions. One, we need to appreciate the question of the divine decree. One, is it possible for a human being to know the future? Two, if it is possible, how then do you reconcile the fact that God and God alone knows the future of the ghaib? Three, and yes, assuming it's possible to know the future, how do you reconcile the fact that when death is certain, the Imam is proceeding for self-destruction? How do you explain that? Four explanations. One, the knowledge of the future of the unseen, what is going to happen in the next moment, the ghaib in the Quran has been ascribed and attributed to God and God alone. God, the absolute and infinite in all his qualities, including his knowledge, alone knows the ghaib. There are numerous verses in the Quran that speaks about this fact. Surah Al-An'am, chapter 6, verse 59. وَعِنْدَهُ مَفَاتِهُ الْغَيْبِ لَا يَعْلَمُهَا إِلَّا هُ وَيَعْلَمُ مَا فِي الْبَرِّ وَالْبَحْرِ وَمَا تَسْقُطُ مِنْ وَرَقَةٍ إِلَّا يَعْلَمُهَا وَلَا حَبَّةٍ فِي ظُلُمَاتِ الْأَرْضِ وَلَا رَطْبٍ وَلَا يَابِسٍ إِلَّا فِي كِتَابٍ مُبِينٍ. Right? He has the keys to the unseen. The unseen treasures are tremendous, but the access to them is in the hands of God and God alone. And therefore he knows whatever is in the earth and whatever is in the depth of the seas. And he knows that every leaf that falls on the ground. And he knows whatever seed has been hidden in the depth of the ground. And there is no dried or wet, but that is recorded in God's knowledge. Fi kitabim mubin. knowledge belongs to God, and God alone has the knowledge of the ghaib. However, on the other hand, we see that the Imams did claim that they had the knowledge of the unseen. For example, these are the narrations of Imam Hussein that I've quoted you about Karbala. How do you reconcile the two? There are several explanations that our scholars have given for the possibility of an imam sharing and having the ilmul ghaib of what is going to happen in the future. There are numerous traditions that clearly shows that the imam knew the ghaib. The question is, how do you reconcile the fact that God alone knows the ghaib? Four explanations. One explanation that is put forth by the scholars is that of compartmentalization, segmentation of the knowledge. There are certain knowledge of the ghaib that God and God alone knows. And then there are certain other segments of the knowledge that God shares with the chosen one. For example, Surah Luqman 31 verse, towards the end, there is a description of five different types of knowledge that God and God alone knows. Right? Here it is. One. Inna Allah indahu ilmu sa'ah. God alone knows when is the hour of the reckoning. Wa yunazzilu al-ghayth. And God alone knows who sends down the rain, where and how much. He alone knows that. Wa ya'lamu ma fil arham. And he alone knows what lies in the womb of the women. Imam Ali says in Nahj al-Balagh, what happens after the child is born? What is going to happen to this individual? What characteristic will it actualize? How will it respond to different situations? And finally, will it gain salvation or will it end up in damnation? God alone knows this. Nobody knows. وَمَا تَدْرِي نَفْسٌ مَاذَا تَكْسِبُ غَدًا. Four, nobody knows what is going to happen tomorrow. And five, وَمَا تَدْرِي نَفْسٌ بِأَيِّ أَرْضٍ تَمُوتٌ. And nobody knows where they will perish and end their lives. إِنَّ اللَّهَ عَلِيمٌ خَبِيرٌ. God alone is all-knowing. There is certain knowledge that God alone knows. And there is certain other knowledge that God shares and gives out. So here is an example again in the Quran. Surah Ali Imran, chapter 3, verse 49. وَرَسُولًا إِلَىٰ بَنِي إِسْرَائِيلٍ. Remember about Jesus who came to his people. أَنِّي قَدْ جِعْتِكُمْ بِآيَاتٍ مِّن رَبِّكُمْ. Let me tell you, I have come with a miracle and I've got a claim and I've got a challenge and a proof for that claim. My claim is that I'm a messenger from God. My proof is that I can do certain extraordinary things that no other human beings can do. Number three, I've got a challenge. See if you can do something like what I can do. If you cannot, then accept me. And what are some of these extraordinary things that the Prophet Isa claimed he could do? He says, أَنِّي أَخْلُكُ لَكُم مِّنَ الطِّينِ كَهَيْئَةِ الطَّيْرِ فَأَنْفَخُ فِيهِ فَتَكُونُ طَيْرًا بِإِذْنِ اللَّهِ. He says, I take an immaterial clay, I shape it like a bird, and then I breathe unto it in the name of God, and by the power of God, it becomes alive. He says, وَأُبْرِئُ الْأَكْمَهَا وَالْأَبْرَصَ وَأُحْيِي الْمَوْتَ بِإِذْنِ اللَّهِ. He says, bring me a dead man and I can bring him back to life. By the power and permission of God, bring me an incurable disease and I can cure it by the power and permission of God. وَأُنَبِّئُكُمْ بِمَا تَأْكُلُونَ وَمَا تَدَّخِرُونَ فِي بُيُوتِكُمْ. He says, I can tell you, each and every one of you, what you have eaten today back home and what you have stored back home, of course, by the permission of God. So compartmentalization, the segmentation of ilmul ghaib, some knowledge specifically to God, while the other knowledge the imam is granted. Yet a second explanation, how a human being can know the future. Knowledge is divided into two types. One is destined and determined and fixed. the other is one which is changing, right? In Surah Rad, chapter 13, verse 39, Allah says, يَمْهُ اللَّهُ مَا يَشَاءُ وَيُثْبِتُ وَعِنْدَهُ أُمُّ الْكِتَابِ. He says, God erases and registers what he wants, and the main book is with him, right? Imam Sajjad, salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi, he says, had it not been for this verse in the Quran, whereby Allah can change the destiny, I could have told you whatever is going to happen till the end of the world, but I cannot because the destiny changes. So the second explanation why the Imams had some knowledge and they did not have other knowledge is because some knowledge is fixed and determined, and God alone knows that final destiny. Some other knowledge is changing. A sinner's life is shortened. A sinner's life suffers affliction. A person who is good to his parents, God prolongs his life, right? Oh, and there are a multitude of factors that play in the day-to-day determination of the destiny of every individual. I cannot predict the future. Yet a third explanation of how an individual can have ilmul ghaib, that though God alone knows all the ghaib, yes, the Imam had the potential to understand if they willed it so. And this says, إِنَّ الْإِمَامَ إِذَا أَرَادَ أَنْ يَعْمَلَ أُلِّمْ, that if the Imam wills, God provides it. If it is in the wisdom of God to share the ilmul ghaib, Allah teaches. If it is not in the wisdom of God, Allah does not provide that knowledge to the Imam. Perhaps sometime the destiny which is to occur, because it is going to be a test for the Imam, God does not share the knowledge. Right? For example, in the night of migration of the Holy Prophet, when Imam Ali had to sleep under the threat of assassination by the enemies, God withholds the knowledge of the outcome of that sleep. Right? Is he going to be really assassinated? Or is he going to be eliminated? Or is he going to survive? Right? Because the real test is, are you ready to sacrifice? We do not know the outcome. Do you love the Prophet enough? Are you devoted to the cause? Sleep, sacrifice. In certain cases, God withholds the knowledge of the unseen. The Imam doesn't know everything. Yet a fourth explanation is that the knowledge, yes, is compartmentalized. It is not that the knowledge is divided into the destined and determined and fixed knowledge and the one that is changing. It is not that the Imam potentially has the capacity to receive the knowledge if he will so, and God, out of his own infinite wisdom, grants him so. No, actually, in reality, in real world, they do have the knowledge of the unseen. Ayatul Kursi, we talked about it last night, verse 255. وَلَا يُحِيطُونَ بِشَيْءٍ مِنْ عِلْمِهِ إِلَّا بِمَا شَاءَ, and they do not comprehend anything of his knowledge except what he wishes. So if an individual and human being can perfect himself to a level where he can elevate himself to obtain the proximity to God, he can be granted the knowledge of the unseen in all affairs, be it destined, be it fixed, be it changing. But that knowledge is the one where the Imam is totally dependent, right? True, there is certain knowledge even the Imam cannot access, that is such as the essence of God, for example, that is beyond comprehension. Nobody has access to the knowledge of the essence of God. In fact, God warns us in Surah Al-Imran, chapter 3, verse number 30. He says, وَيُحَذِّرُكُمُ اللَّهُ نَفْسَهُ, do not come near to me at the level of the essence. To begin to think what God is in his essence is prohibited. Not because God does not want us to know, but because we don't have the capacity to know. Our minds are limited. We work with concepts and mental constructs. Let me exemplify this. If you wanted to have a picnic, you can lay out your mat and place all your goods on it, the chai, the mandazis, and everything else. If you do this on the safety of the land, it is okay, right? But try to do the same thing in the middle of the ocean with the winds blowing 100 miles an hour. The moment you try to keep anything and stabilize it, it is eliminated. When you enter the domain of infinity of the essence of God, where the thinker and the thought and the thinking is all eliminated, there is no way that you can conceptualize and remain and survive. And therefore, the Imam themselves have admitted, "Ma'arafnaka haqqa ma'arifatik." We know you, yes, through the names. We know you through your attributes. We know you through your manifestations and actions of the world. But we don't know you at your essence. We cannot reach you at that level. See, ma'abadnaka haqqa ibadatik. And because of that, hence we cannot worship you in the manner that you and you alone deserve to be worshipped. Excluding this domain, the rest, there is a possibility for the Imam to reach a level where he can be granted the knowledge of everything, including, therefore, whatever is going to happen in Karbala. Salawat ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. The next question then is, if the Imam knows that he is going to die, how can you willingly proceed to self-destruction? Right? Well, there's a verse in the Quran which is often quoted on this concept in Surah Al-Baqarah 195, ayah number 125. وَلَا تُلْقُوا بِأَيْدِيكُمْ إِلَى التَّهْلُكَةِ. And do not proceed to certain death. Right? Do not plunge into the death. This ayah would tell us that if you know for certain that death is inevitable because of your action, then do not self-destruct. Do not commit suicide. How come? If the Imam knew about the impending death in Karbala, yet he proceeds for self-destruction? The scholars have responded to this potential question by saying, one, this ayah is not addressed to the Imam. I will explain why it's not addressed to the Imam. Hold your thoughts. Two, yes, it is addressed to the Imam, but the death that is talked about in this verse is not a physical death. Three, no, it is a physical death. But it is a death which is meaningful, whose consequences and outcome override its negative effect. The death which is prohibited, which is meaningless, which is fruitless, which is unproductive, which is destructive, which is therefore not a death which is productive. Three possible reasons. Allow me to elaborate. One reason the scholars present to us is that the verse does not talk about the Imam. It does not address the Imam on the subject of self-destruction. Have you observed in the Quran that there's a narration of Prophet Musa and Khidr in Surah Al-Kahf, and they're having a conversation together? Khidr begins to damage a boat. And Musa says to him, "No, you shouldn't do that. That belongs to somebody else. How can you do that?" And then they reach a town where Khidr kills a young boy. And Musa says to him, "How dare you execute this young man?" And then they reach a place where the building is collapsing. And Khidr reconstructs the wall. Right? The domain and the spheres that these two prophets are operating are diametrically in the opposite. One is working in the apparent world while the other one is working behind the curtain. God, for a temporary moment, lifts up the veil and we see how the unseen world operates. Khidr now explains to Musa his action in Surah Al-Kahf from verse 79. Listen to this, it's interesting. He says, "Amma safinatu fakanat limasakini ya'maluna fil bahr fa'aradta an a'ibaha wa kana wara'ahum malikun ya'khudhuhu kullu safinatin ghadaba." He says, "Let me explain to you why I damaged the boat. There was a tyrant who was behind this man. He would have confiscated that boat. In order to save him, I have damaged the boat. Temporary damage to ensure long-term benefit. Sometimes we come across situations where we are afflicted with suffering. We become sick and stresses is beyond our control, right? We do not know. Perhaps it's a temporary damage and a harm for a long-term benefit. In the case of Musa, it was Khidr doing it, and Khidr was operating in the unseen world. The curtain was just temporarily lifted for us to see that. وَأَمَّا الْغُلَامُ فَكَانَ أَبَوَاهُ مُؤْمِنَيْنِ فَخَشِينَا أَنْ يُرْهِقَهُمَا تُغْيَانًا وَكُفْرًا فَأَرَدْنَا أَنْ يُبْدِلَهُمَا رَبُّهُمَا خَيْرًا مِنْهُ زَكَاةً وَأَقْرَبَ رُوحَمَا. And secondly, the reason why I killed the young man, because his parents were good people. They were faithful. We were afraid that when he grows up, he would lead his parents to deviation and to disbelief. Our decree, wherefore, was to remove this young man and substitute him. In the unseen world that we live in, we could have become sick and died. But God opens and removes the veil and shows us how the death occurs, right? The young man was killed. In our case, we would say, my God, the person died young. We do not know. But perhaps there is a decree. God wanted to substitute. The riwayah has a very interesting explanation. The boy was removed and they were given a girl. And you know who was this girl? Ayatollah Makarim Shirazi in Tafsir al-Amthal says, oh my God, the girl went on to become the mother of more than 70 prophets of God. Sometimes a girl can be a better choice than a boy. Remember Zainab alayhi salam, right? وَأَمَّا الْجِدَارُ فَكَانَ لِغُلَامَيْنِ يَتِيمَيْنِ فِي الْمَدِينَةِ وَكَانَ تَحْتَهُ كَنْزٌ لَهُمَا. And in the third case, that wall that was reconstructed, a damaged building, it should be destroyed and reconstruct something else. The damage was restored temporarily to preserve something, right? It had a treasure underneath that belonged to two orphan kids who were immature to possess it. What? We want time to let them grow up. The interesting part here is that God does not abandon anyone if the parents have done something good. God takes care of the children, right? No. Look at the hadith. It's amazing. The hadith says it was not the immediate parents who left the wealth behind for the children. It was their great, great, great grandfather who left the wealth behind. Amazing. What I do today, its effect will not show in my first generation. It will not show in my second generation. It will not show in my third generation. It will show multiple generations down the road. As God says in Surah Yasin, وَنَكْتُبُ مَا قَدَّمُوا وَآثَارَهُمْ وَكُلَّ شَيْءٍ أَحْصَيْنَاهُ فِي إِمَامٍ مُبِينٍ. We write down what they have presented in their works, and we have recorded everything in Imam Mubin. It is inconceivable in a universe which is run by an all-wise who is all-loving Lord for any individual to perform a small act of virtue, but that it is recorded and rewarded, not immediately, over generations down the road. Right? That is how, my dear brothers and sisters, the unseen world works. Salawat ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Don't self-destruct. The verse is not talking to the imam, because the imam works in a different domain. The imam works in the domain of Khidr, not the domain of Musa. That's one possible explanation. The second possible explanation, when you know it is death, don't self-destruct. The ayah is addressed to the imam, but the death is not physical. You see, the preceding part of the ayah and the succeeding part of the ayah, what does it talk about? وَأَنْفِقُوا فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ, and spend in the way of God. That is the first part of the ayah. وَأَحْسِنُوا إِنَّ اللَّهَ يُحِبُّ الْمُحْسِنِينَ, and the last part of the ayah, spend and be kind. And in the middle, don't self-destruct. Right? Right. So if I don't spend, Allah, if I don't spend and if I'm not kind, I destroy myself physically? No. Socially? Maybe. Politically? Maybe. Economically? Maybe. God will punish me in those areas. So true, the verse may be talking to the mom, but who is saying it is talking about physical death? Don't self-destruct. And yet a third explanation is no, the ayah is talking to the imam. Yes, the death is physical, but sometimes death is more important than life. Look at the declaration of the imams. At various stages in the movement to Karbala, he says, "Inni la aral maut illa sa'ada wal hayat ma'al zalimina illa barama." He says, "I will never ever subjugate myself to the tyranny of this despotic ruler, because life with dishonor is worse than death with dignity." Sometimes death is more important than life. If the goals you have to achieve are much larger and much higher in the eyes of God. So let me conclude. It's true that one of the factors that determine the occurrence of Karbala was the divine decree. But it was a divine decree whereby the imam was given the option that it is your duty under these circumstances, that in order to establish godly values, in order to eliminate the vices, in order to introduce reformation in a corrupt society, in order to re-establish the godly practice of the Holy Prophet and the first imam, that in such a situation, not only the imam, but every mu'mineen, every believer who has the belief in the truth of godly value must make an uprise. Right? أَلَا تَرَوْنَ إِلَى الْحَقِّ إِلَّا يُعْمَلُ بِهِ. Don't you see the truth is being abandoned and trampled upon? أَلَا تَرَوْنَ إِلَى الْبَاطِلْ لَا يُتَنَاهَ عَنْ. Look at falsehood. Falsehood is being embraced. لِيَرْغَبَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ فِي لِقَاءِ اللَّهِ الْحَقِّ. In such circumstances, it behooves not me as an imam, it behooves every believer to make an uprise, to eliminate vice and to establish virtue. So the divine decree was not something that was imposed on the imam. It was a decree whereby the imam was given the option that the future of the ummah depends on making a choice for sacrifice. Are you ready? And the imam says, Ridhana Ahlul Bayt Ridhullah. Yes, what is pleasing God is most satisfying for us. That was a conscious, willful, deliberate decision to give up one's life for the sake of godly value. That, my dear brothers and sisters, is not self-destruction. That is self-preservation on a long-term basis. Salawat ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. And finally, this reality was even shared with those who are close companions of the imam. And they knew the outcome, right? There is a narration. The message of the narration is not difficult to accept if you eliminate the authenticity of the hadith. It says two companions of Imam Ali, they're walking the streets of Kufa, right? They're discussing with each other. One says, "I can see a man who will be lynched." And that is referring to Maytham al-Tammar. And Maytham replies, "I see a man who's red-faced, who shall be killed in the way of God, and his head will be chopped, and he'll be brought back to Kufa," referring to Habib ibn Mazahir. The people around the two characters, they said that we have never met more two people who are more bigger liars than these two. And yet a third man joins in. He says, "I think Maytham forgot one more important detail. When the head will be chopped and brought back to Kufa, it will be rewarded with 100 dirhams more than all the other heads." The people said, "Wow, this third one is the biggest liar all of them." Ilmul Ghaib was even shared with the companions who are close to the imam. Therefore, it's not surprising that Zainab alayhi salam knew what the situation is going to be. She knew very well the entire sequence of events that are going to take place. That she will have to carry that banner all the way from Karbala to Kufa to Sham and back to Karbala and back to Medina. Right? And last night, we began paying our tribute to the family of Hussein alayhi salam, is I shared with how the Ahl al-Bayt were taken from Karbala to Kufa and then to Sham. Yazid made every attempt possible to humiliate the family of the Prophet. The more he did so, the more he humiliated himself. Right? The more he tried to disrespect the head of Imam Hussein, the more the people turned against him. We saw, for example, the khutbah of Sayyid Zainab and the khutbah of Imam Sajjad, how it changed the people's mind and it changed the people's heart, right? And when Yazid realized that this was a threat to him, instead of allowing the people, allowing the family of the Prophet to interact with the public, he placed them in the prison, hoping to keep them in the prison for a very, very long time. Tonight, we want to talk about the release of the Ahl al-Bayt from this prison and the circumstances by which they were released. I also want to take this opportunity very briefly to pay tribute to the daughter of Imam Hussein, famously known as Sakina. Her real name was Ruqayya bint al-Hussein. This daughter of Imam Hussein, in our culture, where we use the Urdu in poetry, we have a number of these poets who refer to her as Sakina. And she has become immortalized, in a sense, by this name Sakina. According to some historical narration, she was referred to as Sakina. She was referred by many alqabs, She was known as Atika. She was known as Zainab. Why was she also known as Sakina? Because Sakina means tranquility, right? It is recorded in history that whenever this child was around people, she brought a sense of peace and tranquility around her. And we are told in history that despite of her young age, when the kafila arrived in Sham, sometimes the women would be overwhelmed and they would start crying and wailing. And this daughter of Hussein would console the ladies. She had the capacity to give this great compassion, so much so that she would bring peace to Imam Hussein alayhi salam. There are verses of poetry of Imam Hussein in which he says, "I do not like the house in which Rabab and Sakina are not present." The Imam would read stories to her and she would fall asleep. But history tells us from the second of Muharram onwards, the Imam would encourage her to go to sleep with her aunt Zainab or with Rabab, as if to prepare her that one day, Sakina, you will be alone and I will not be there. This young child went from Karbala to Kufa to Sham. We are told that a number of times this young child would fall from the camel, and because of this they would tie her so she doesn't fall down. And because the ropes are so thick, her arms are so thin, that they tied a rope around her neck. In one of the riwayat, they say that they tied her around in front of Imam Sajjad, her neck to the hands of Imam Sajjad. Why? So Imam Sajjad would have to constantly bend his back, otherwise the rope would strangle Sakina. So to stop Sakina suffocating, the Imam would walk all the way to Sham with his back bent. And we are told that Sakina, when she died in the prison, holding the head of her father, when the ghassala came to wash her body, the ghassala did not touch the body of Sakina. She approached Imam Sajjad and asked, "Did this child suffer from some kind of disease?" The Imam replied, "No. What you see is the welt from the whips that this child underwent. These are the marks of the torture." The ghassala tried to remove the dress from the Sakina, but she could not do so. Some parts of the dress were burned. Some parts of the dress were stuck to the wounds on her body. The Hind, the wife of Yazid, says, "One day I slept after the death of Sakina, and what happens is I saw in my dream the messenger of God had arrived, the heavens had opened up, and he was talking to the head of Hussein. He cries at the head of Hussein and he says, 'My grandson, what have they done to you? Here is your father Ali and here is your mother Fatima.' He says, 'I woke up from my dream frightened. I began looking for Yazid. I found Yazid in another room sitting in the dark corner and hitting his head against the wall and saying, "Mali walil Hussein." I asked him, 'What is his condition, O Yazid?' He said, 'I cannot sleep. Every time I sleep, I have a nightmare. Every time I sleep, I see the messenger of God come to me and I says, "What has my Hussein done to you? Why have you imprisoned my children?" He pleaded with Yazid and said, "Well, why don't you let them go?" Yazid calls Imam Sajjad the next day and says, "Oh, son of Hussein, you are free to go. Yazid says, you can stay here in Sham if you want, or you can leave and go back. Imam Sajjad says to Yazid, I will give you an answer tomorrow until I have talked to my aunt Zainab. Imam Sajjad goes back to the prison and talks to Zainab. And my aunt, we have now been freed. Zainab says, go and tell Yazid, we need a house to be set up. A house is set up. This is a house that was, this is the defeat of Zainab. This is the defeat of Yazid. He killed Hussein, but he sets up the house for the majlis of Hussein. A house was set up. The heads of the shuhada were brought. Every woman took their heads of their husband and the brother, and they started wailing and crying. The women of Sham arrived to console Zainab alayhi salam. For 3 days or 7 days, they continued to mourn and they keep on crying, Wa Husayna, Wa Husayna. ألا لعنة الله على القوم الظالمين وسيعلم الذين ظلموا آل محمد ينقلبين ينقلبون مع تمع حسين نزديكك لقام جبه Poncha kafila Bola bashira Is jap khayme te mere aka Sadat Karbala Chalum ko kat laga hame jab aaye mubtila Sada behosh hoke gir pari hu to se bibiya abid ki sun fihan Zainab pukari beta ye jang gal hai kon sa sadat karbala chalum ko kat laga hame sada abed pukare kyun fufi tum ko khabar nahi ye hai wohi zameen baba ko mere qatl kiya ghar diya jala Karbala Chalum ko ka Aaye mubtila Sada Sab ahl bayt Rote huwe kat laga hame
lascio codun de pae. Rek bibi lasce pebe ti Juda Juda sada te Karbala chelum ko kat. Tela sada asghar ki lash par giri ba nu bashoroshen e mere dil Utho pyare ma se lipat jao to zara sada te Karbala chelum ko kat laga hame jab aaye ho tera
saadat e Karbala saadat e Karbala chehlum ko Karbala mein jab aayi wo bibiyan Saadat-e-Karbala Chehlum ko Karbala mein jab aayi wo bibiyan Saadat-e-Karbala Kuch bibiyan yahan hai, kuch bibiyan wahan, karti hui fugha, karti hui fugha, bikhri hui thi maqtale sarwar mein ja baja Saadat-e-Karbala Chehlum ko Karbala mein jab aayi wo bibiyan Saadat-e-Karbala Ek bibi dasht-e-khooni mein jaati hai nehr par kehti bachashmetar kehti bachashmetar abbas dene aayi hu pursa sakina ka saadat-e-karbala chehlum ko Karbala mein jab aayi wo bibiyan Saadat-e-Karbala Ghut ghut ke laadli teri zindaan mein mar gayi Turbat wahi bani Turbat bani Bhaiya wo qaid se na huwi mar ke bhi reha Saadat-e-Karbala Chehlum ko Karbala mein jab aayi wo bibiyan Saadat-e-Karbala اکبر کی قبر پر یوں ہوئی لیلا نوحگر، دیکھا نہ سال بھر، دیکھا نہ سال بھر، آئی ہوں قید شام سے اب ہو کے میں رہا، سادات کربلا، سادات کربلا، چہلم کو کربلا میں جب
آئی وہ بی بیا،
سادات کربلا، بانو یہ بین کرتی تھی ہے میرے بے زبان، ماں ڈھونڈے اب کہاں، ماں ڈھونڈے اب کہاں، بتلا دے ہے کہاں میرا اصغر ہے کربلا، سادات کربلا،
سادات کربلا، چہلوں کو کربلا میں جب آئی وہ بی بیا، سادات کربلا، سادات کربلا، حیران پریشان ہے، حیران پریشان ہے کرب و بلا میں زینب، کس کو منائے زینب، کس کو سنبھال زینب، کس کو منائے زینب، کس کو سنبھال زینب، حیران پریشان ہے، حیران و پریشان ہے کرب و بلا میں زینب، کس کو منائے زینب، کس کو سنبھال زینب، سب کو سنبھالنا ہے، خیموں میں آگ پھیلی، کربل کے بن میں دکھ یا اب رہ گئی اکیلی، کون آئے گا مدد کو، کون آئے گا مدد کو، کس کو پکار زینب، کس کو منائے زینب، کس کو پال زینب، کس کو منائے زینب، کس کو سنبھال زینب، سر رکھ کے جو بابا کے سینے پہ سونے والی، پانی کو ترستی تھی نازوں کے پلنے والی، معصوم سکینہ کو، معصوم سکینہ کو کیسے منائے زینب، کس کو منائے زینب، کس کو سنبھال زینب، کس کو منائے زینب، کس کو سنبھال زینب، دیکھ کر سہارا عابد بیمار کو اٹھایا، بڑھ کے ہوئے شولوں سے سجاد کو بچایا، تنہائی میں اٹھایا، تنہائی میں اٹھایا، ہر ایک کا بھار زینب، کس کو منائے زینب، کس کو سنبھال زینب، کس کو منائے زینب، کس کو سنبھال زینب، حیران پریشان ہے، حیران پریشان ہے کرب و بلا میں زینب، کس کو سنبھال زینب، کس کو سنبھال، یا حسین، یا حسین، یا حسین، یا حسین، یا حسین، Ya Hussein, 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 Ya Hussein,